Next up, Henry Jenkins.
So when I arrived at MIT some 25 years ago, I was part of a remarkable learning culture called the Narrative Intelligence Group. One of the things we read was the work of Seymour Papert, a 1977 article about learning cultures, specifically in the land of Geppetto, the land of Brazil. So I've now connected two of the talks together. Wait and see. What he told us about the culture in Rio was that it was a place that seemed informal, chaotic, and yet deeply social, out of which came this open source project that is really focused on building the floats, designing the dances, developing the themes for Carnival. It's a learning culture that was very rich and very vibrant and very deeply embedded in the culture. He tells us that there is that sort of around this the activity are a whole bunch of mechanisms for getting people to participate. None of which, by the way, involve giving people badges for anything. These people on the stage are developing, and it's a place where adults and youth learn side by side, where noobs and experienced players are involved in joint activities. Out of which emerge new kinds of expressive life. If you look at the space, there's always peripheries and always looking in, and what he tells us is that experienced dancers will call a circle around them and engage them in the activity of dance. It may last 10 minutes, it may last a half an hour, it may last an hour. What he challenges at the end of this 1977 article is that we take this work and begin to read it as a model for what education might look like. And it might very well look like something like the U-Media centers, which are conducted through libraries. Got all of them. Now, when I went to Rio last summer, I visited the favelas and was taken to see a samba school. This is sort of the neighborhood you see the samba schools in. There's a lot of expressive and social activity taking place outside. Yet this ticket window tells us something about the crime rate of the community where this takes place. It's not necessarily always the most hospitable space, especially for visitors, but you get through the ticket window and get inside, and you're treated with extraordinary hospitality. You're served good food. You're encouraged to become part of this community. All kinds of activities are going on around you, and what you see from all corners are people beginning to participate, learning and leaning in to see what's taking place. This one really interests me because this balcony is maybe the outer periphery, the hall, and they're further stretching out with their cell phones, texting their friends, maybe inviting them in, but it's part of the larger mechanism or apparatus around which participation is encouraged. The day that I was there was a kind of romance festival. These guys were sending out valentines. They were messengers that lovers could send valentines to each other and draw them into dance. And another sort of mechanism encouraging participation. And then midway through the ceremony, this group of people in uniforms came marching through, grabbing people out of the crowd and taking them to the back room to give them a lecture because they weren't participating. This is the disciplinary sign. This is the participation police that's encouraging. Now, being terrified of authority, I frantically said, what do I have to do to participate? And I quickly was told I could put the shirt on, and I became a decorative element in the participation, because I'm not a dancer, but I can at least look cute. Now, I think that we should use this to challenge this kind of frequent pyramids of participation, which assume certain activities are uniquely valuable, that activity is hierarchical, that those people who are not participating in the most active way are simply lurkers, and instead I'm finding myself drawn more and more back to the notion of legitimate peripheral participation, of fluidity and flow across spaces, build mechanisms in that encourage participation, but don't necessarily assume that everyone who's watching is not participating. Now, like some of you, I read this remarkable blog post on the DML Hub just a few weeks ago about the digital culture of Brazil. This is a place with a vibrant folk culture that's moving into the digital space. And what we saw on this piece by Raquel Ricciero was the ways that YouTube may now function as the modern samba school, a place that people are exchanging moves, learning from each other, communicating across divisions in that society. This is a deeply porous space. Someone sent me last week this article about New Orleans, where there's an unaffiliated crew, the crew of Chewbacca's, that combines Star Wars and Bacchus together, that's created a new space of participation in an otherwise traditional culture. So again, I recommend to you Papert's 1977 essay, and I hope that we can begin to incorporate it into our own discussions of what constitutes a participatory culture and a learning culture today. Thank you.